My name is Stefania Cidoni. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at the Laboratory of Food Chemistry and Technology, School of Chemical Engineering, National Technical University of Athens. Within the next hour, we'll discuss about novel methods for shelf life extension for fish products, focusing on gillhead, sea bream, and sea bass. Triton described extensively the food quality definition and aspects. I'll tell you two or three words about that. Consumers all over the world demand foods of high quality and standards. Quality means different things for different products. Food quality may be its sensory characteristics, nutritional value, or safety. Quality is a dynamic state moving to reduced levels. High quality life is defined as the time from processing of a product to the development of that noticeable sensory difference. And practical storage life is the period of proper storage after processing of an initially high quality product, during which the organoleptic quality remains suitable for consumption. Large amounts of food are wasted in the food supply chain. One important cause of food losses is expiring best before date at the time of consumption. A large amount of food waste refers to fisheries. The limited and variable shelf life of chilled fish products is a major problem for their quality assurance and commercial viability. Products such as chilled fillets from marine culture Mediterranean fish have a high commercial potential if their shelf life can be extended through packaging or minimal processing. With decreasing consumer demands for fresh products with extended shelf life and increasing energy costs associated with freezing and frozen storage, the fish processing industry is actively seeking alternative methods of shelf life preservation and marketability of fresh refrigerated fish, and at the same time economizing energy costs. Extending the shelf life will reduce weight not only at consumer level, but also at retail, eliminating the financial burden of disposed products and environmental damage. Spoilage of chilled, fresh, and minimally processed fish is attributed mainly to bacterial activity, leading in changes of the sensory characteristics. The dominant spoilage parameters depend on treatment, packaging, and storage conditions. For this reason, considerable research focuses on the control of microbial and related biochemical reactions to improve the quality and extend the shelf life by treatment and packaging. This course will illustrate the opportunities of non-thermal and other innovative processing technologies in adding value to fish products and extend their shelf life. We'll see examples with modified atmosphere packaging, osmotic treatment, and high hydrostatic pressure. I'll describe you the methodology for shelf life modeling of food, and we'll discuss about cold chain management using time temperature integrators. Ilhethi bream and sivas are Mediterranean species of high commercial value due to their desirable characteristics. Although usually as whole fish, filleted products are of high interest but suffer from shorter shelf life. Modified atmosphere packaging replaces the atmospheric air inside the packets with a protective gas mix. Modified atmosphere packaging provides sufficient shelf life for foods with the absolute least amount of damage to quality, texture, taste and nutrition. Carbon dioxide exhibits bacteriostatic and phagostatic properties in MAP fish. And MAP has, as we discussed in the previous presentation, has been used successfully to extend the raw fish fillet shelf life for many species. Partial water removal by osmotic dehydration has received increased attention as a pretreatment to improve stability and nutritional and sensory parameters of food. During the osmotic dehydration, water flows from the product in the osmotic solution, while osmotic solute is transferred from the solution to the product. By reducing the water activity of the food, microbial growth is reduced. The solute choice depends on the expected water loss in solid gain and the sensory properties of the final product. Antimicrobial agents are substances used to preserve foods by preventing growth of microorganisms and subsequent spoilage, including phagocytes, mold and ROP inhibitors. The exact mechanism of their antimicrobial action is not completely known. Modes of action include the inhibition of cell wall synthesis, protein synthesis, and cell division. A wide range of antimicrobial systems has been examined for their potential use in food preservation. Recent studies investigate the effect of natural antimicrobial systems on the shelf life of these products. Some examples that I will show you next are carvacrol, which is the major component of the essential oil fraction of oregano and thym, gluconodelta-lacton, which is hydrolyzed to form gluconic acid, as is widely used in acidified meat products. A commercial antimicrobial system, Citrox, which is a nutritional food supplement combination of citrus bioflavonoids, vitamins, and naturally occurring organic acids. And Nisin, which is a bacteriocin produced by Lactococcus lactis and has a much broader spectrum than most other bacteriocins, being active against a wide range of gram-positive bacteria. Supergilling is a technology that consists of storing food just below the initial freezing temperature. At superchilling temperatures, most microbial activity is inhibited. However, ice forming and recrystallization can cause structural changes to food, resulting in cell dehydration, drip loss, and tissue shrinkage. For this reason, several studies investigate the use of cryoprotective agents. Several compounds have been found to be cryoprotective in frozen foods, increasing the amount of unfrozen water in tissue and stabilizing proteins. Sometimes these agents can give a sweet taste and high calor value in the final product. For this reason, there have been investigated alternative cryoprotectants. Minimal or mild processes offer the potential to further increase the shelf life of food, combining different preservative factors that microorganisms are unable to overcome. That's for this reason, this technique is called Hartle technology. According to the current legislation, the date of minimum durability of a food is the date until which the food retains its specific properties when properly stored. For this reason, there's a systematic modeling of temperature dependence of the target food product is very important for shelf life optimization and improvement of the chill chain management. Reliable kinetic equations for shelf life determination validated at dynamic conditions can provide effective tools for predicting food quality and shelf life. I will describe now the general methodology for self-life modeling of foods. In general, the loss of food quality or self-life is evaluated by measuring a characteristic quality index, let's say A. The change of index A with time is usually described by this kinetic fluctuation. K is called the rate constant, depending on temperature, product composition, and packaging. N is the reaction order, which determines the shape of the deterioration curve. This equation will give the final quality function of the product. During product development, there's usually the need for a preliminary self-life knowledge. Self-life testing is often accelerated to evaluate the effects of various parameters of self-life, for example, for frozen products. A general procedure for self-life testing includes the development of testing protocol, identification of key quality indicators, estimation of product sample and control needs, the selection of proper package materials and package size. We choose storage conditions, estimate sampling frequency and duration of testing, then schedule the execution, take samples and evaluate the quality, and data analyzing. The temperature dependence of the quality loss rates can be described using different methods. Arrhenius equation gives the activation energy value. High activation energy values mean high temperature sensitivity. An alternative to the Arrhenius law is the Q10 concept, a tool of practical importance to the food industry. Q10 shows the reduction of self-life when the food is stored at temperature 10 degrees higher. One most practical method to describe the temperature dependence of a food product is half-life temperature. It is a temperature increase that leads to half self-life. Now we will see all these steps with a real example, let's say with a frozen shrimp. First of all, the quality indicators are identified. In this case, there are T-bars for lipid oxidation, PBBN, instrumentally measured the color and texture, and microbial stability measuring total viable count, and sensory characteristics. Samples are packed, in this case in their commercial packages, and stored isothermally at the minus 5, minus 8, minus 12, and minus 15 degrees C. Sampling frequency is estimated. Generally, the more analyses are completed, the more accurate will be the self-life determination. Then the samples were taken at predetermined times, and we construct the curve. Data analyzed, and values of the different measure indices are plotted versus time, and the apparent order of quality loss is determined based on statistical analysis. Here is this procedure for TVBN, where we have a first order reaction. We estimate K at each storage temperature, construct the Arrhenius plot, and calculate the activation energy. This value indicates a high temperature sensitivity of the product. For sensory scores, there is a zero order reaction that describes the sensory changes. With the same procedure, we calculate the K values, construct the Arrhenius plot, and determine the activation energy value. Furthermore, we combine the all data, and in this case, we show that the time with organoleptic rejection coincided with an average TVBN value of 25, which can be said as the limit of acceptability for the self-life determination. Based on the above, we develop mathematical models that for the determination of self-life at any storage temperature in the studied range. exactly the same procedure can be used for any other product. And here is an example with frozen Gilead sea bream and Simba's fillets. Fillets were individually packed in vacuum and stored at minus 5, minus 8, minus 12, and minus 15 degrees Celsius. The quality indicators were identified and shelf-life study was implemented. In this case, shelf value, which is the lightness comes from instrumental measurement of color, was a good quality index following a zero-order reaction at all storage temperatures. TVBN was also a good quality index following first-order reaction. And we constructed similar mathematical models for self-life determination at any selective storage temperature. Here we can see that we have carried out experiments at the four temperatures, minus 5, minus 8, minus 12, and minus 15 degrees C, and we are able to calculate, to extrapolate using the mathematical models, the self-life at minus 18 degrees C.
So it's a lot of, you extend quite a lot of time, 1 year or more. Or,
at minus...
minus 15 or whatever, all the range.
Mm-hmm.
In minus 18 you have 2 years or whatever it is.
You have something similar for TBA, for lipid oxidation?
It's in another study which is not presented here. But the values
similar.
Are quite similar. Now we will see how these mathematical models can be used in real conditions. A realistic distribution scenario simulated that includes four stages. We have storage in the packing plant, transportation and storage in a distribution center, stage 3, which is a retail display, and 4, the storage and domestic freezers. The effective temperature that is calculated for each separate stage is a constant temperature which results in the same quality value as the variable temperature distribution. The extent of of quality deterioration at the end of each distribution phase was then estimated using the developed mathematical models. Quality is expressed here as a remaining shelf life, which is the time for the product to reach sensory unacceptability at the determined storage temperature, which is in this case minus 15 degrees C. So we will see that if the product is not stored at the recommended storage temperatures, at the end of the fourth stage, we have 63 or 83 days remaining shelf life instead of 265 and 258 for its product. This methodology is not only used for frozen products, the same methodology is, can be used in any storage range, determining in each case different quality indicators. Here's a study for chilled modified atmosphere packed Gilead sea bream fillets. These fillets are packed aerobically and in different MAP conditions at 0, 5, 10 and 15 degrees C. MAP was achieved in laboratory using the appropriate path cutting machine and headspace analysis with the gas analyzer. Quality assessment was based on microbiological analysis and on physicochemical and sensory parameters that are relevant at chilled conditions. In this case, Pseudomonas growth defines spoilage at aerobic conditions and Lactobacilli at MAP conditions. And a mathematical model was developed for the calculation of shelf life at different CO2 levels and different storage temperatures. Here are calculations of the shelf life of Gilead sea bream fillets under several MAP conditions at 0 and 5 degrees C using the developed mathematical model. These calculations can be illustrated on these combined shelf life curves for all the conditions. As we can see, the higher the CO2 concentration and the lower the storage temperature, the longer the shelf life of the fillets. In order to evaluate the applicability of the developed models under non-isothermal conditions, the model was validated at dynamic conditions. Samples were stored at two variable temperature scenarios, and the measured microbial growth was compared to the predicted by the models. In each case, the error of prediction was satisfactory, so the model can predict the microbial growth of MAP gilt exhibitor fillets under non-isothermal conditions. Conclusively, the results of the study show the potential of using MAP to extend shelf life and improve commercial value of SLP's products. The preservative effect of CO2 was greater as the CO2 concentration in the atmosphere increased. The validation of the model showed that it can predict satisfactorily the growth of lactic acid bacteria on MAP gilt sibling fillets under non-isothermal conditions and can be applied reliably in the dynamic temperature conditions of the real chilled egg. These models, in correlation with the organoleptic expression of spoilers, can be a reliable tool for predicting the shelf life of MAP fish. The developed model was finally validated in the real chill chain by a simulation experiment of the product distribution. 80 MAP fish packages with 50% CO2 were stored at five different temperature scenarios in programmable temperature distributions. Then products were split 72 hours from packing, corresponding to the distribution center, and followed a simulated path to a local and distant market. Half of the samples were then stored at 4 degrees C and half at 8 degrees C for different times, simulating the different times of final consumption. Lactic acid bacteria were measured at these times, and the values were compared to the predicted by the mathematical model. The predictions were satisfactory, with 96% being below 20%. The errors were below 20%. A slight overprediction of the lactobacilli is on the conservative side, as 74% of the error values are negative below the horizontal axis, indicating slightly higher predicted than observed values. Now we'll show you the effect of another technique, which is osmotic pretreatment alone and in combination with modified atmosphere packaging on the shelf life of gilt sibrim fillets. Sibrim fillets were cut into slices and osmotically pretreated at selected conditions. We used an osmotic solution with 50% maltodextrin strength and sodium chloride, which was added to increase the osmotic driving force between the process, during the process, and attenuate the low sweetness from the maltodextrin uptake. At predetermined time, samples were removed from the osmotic solution and weighed. Maltodextrin was selected as a osmotic solute because it has low sweetness and relatively small molecular weight. During the pretreatment, water loss, solid gain, water activity, and sodium chloride are monitored in order to select the optimum processing conditions. Control samples and samples treated for 45 minutes were packed in air or in a map and stored at 0, 5, 10, and 15 degrees C. Map conditions in this case were again 50% CO2 and 50% air. The quality assessment was based on microbial growth, chemical changes, and sensory parameters. We can see that pretreated samples showed improved quality stability during refrigerated storage in terms of microbial growth, chemical changes, and organoleptic degradation. Modified atmosphere packaging further increase the shelf life of gilt-head seabream fillets with a combination of osmotic pretreatment and MAP, giving the higher values, the highest values. The developed mathematical models can be used for the prediction of shelf life at any storage temperature, as we see here for with the developed shelf life curves. Conclusively, the results of the study show the potential of using modified atmosphere packaging alone or in combination with osmotic pretreatment to extend the shelf life and improve commercial value of fresh fish products. Mainly Pseudomonas and hydrogen sulfate producing bacteria were found to dominate the spoilage under aerobic conditions, which were strongly inhibited by CO2 in MAP packages. Microbial growth was significantly inhibited in osmotically pretreated samples at all storage temperatures, and the pretreated samples were found to have improved quality stability during refrigerated storage in terms of microbial growth, TBBN changes, and organoleptic gradation, resulting in significant shelf life extension at all storage temperatures. The osmotic pretreatment in combination with the modified atmosphere packaging was the most effective treatment for the preservation of gilt-head seabream fillets, followed by MAP, osmotic pretreatment, and untreated samples. And now we'll see the effect of the addition of antimicrobial agents in the osmotic solution on the shelf life of gilt-head seabream fillets. Processing time of 45 minutes was again selected as the reference pretreatment for the shelf life study. These processing conditions led to a level of water loss and solid uptake that allows the product to retain optimum sensory characteristics. The sensory rejection, in this case, considered with a Pseudomonas level of 6 logs and a TBBN level of 22. We combine all these calculations, and we get the shelf life of untreated and treated products. Gluconyl delta lactone was the most effective agent, followed by carvacrol and citrox. Similar mathematical models were also developed in this case for the prediction of shelf life at any storage temperature. So we conclude that the use of antimicrobial agents gave additional shelf life increase of treated fillets with carvacrol, gluconyl delta lactone, and citrox, showing similar antimicrobial activity. Also, carvacrol showed also the antioxidant activity, but affected significantly the taste of the fish. Now we will combine all the above techniques. The osmotic hydration, modified atmosphere packaging, and the addition of the antimicrobial agents. Untreated and osmotically pretreated samples, with and without nicin in the osmotic solution, were packed aerobically or under modified atmospheres and stored at controlled isothermal conditions of 0, 5, 10, 15 degrees C and at dynamic conditions for shelf life study. Here is the growth rates of the measured microorganisms in the various treatments in storage conditions. Pseudomonas dominated the spoilage at aerobic conditions and lactobacilli at MAP conditions. Osmotic pretreatment with nicin and MAP led to slower microbial growth compared to the other conditions. So with the same procedure with the previous experiments, we calculate the shelf life of all the processing conditions. The limits for shelf life was again 6 logs for Pseudomonas or Lactobacilli for aerobic storage and MAP respectively, and TBBN of 22. Nicin further extended the shelf life of smoothly pretreated and MAP samples at all storage temperatures. And we constructed similar mathematical models for the determination of shelf life at any storage temperature. The developed mathematical models were validated at non-isothermal conditions and the predicted values were in agreement with experimental values. This combined technique was also tested for tuna samples using the same osmotic solution and Nicene concentration in the solution. And it was concluded that osmotic treatment led to significant shelf life extension of tuna in terms of microbial growth and sensory quality. The addition of Nicene was also in this case further increased the shelf life of the treated fish. It is concluded that the results of the study show the potential of using osmotic pretreatment in combination with Nicene as antimicrobial agent and MAP to extend the shelf life and improve the commercial value of fresh fish products. The osmotic pretreatment in combination with MAP was the most effective treatment for the preservation of fish, followed by MAP, osmotic pretreatment, and untreated samples. Nicene gave additional effect on the shelf life of pre-treated samples stored aerobically or under MAP. The final application regarding osmotic pretreatment combines the addition of alternative solutes in the osmotic solution as cryoprotectants during super chilled storage of pre-treated fish. Fillets were cut into slices and osmotically pretreated at selected conditions. Three osmotic solutions were used at 15 degrees C processing. The concentrations of trehalose and glucosamine were based on their solubility. We chose trehalose, which has a low caloric value, low sweetness, and authorized use based on the European regulations. Glucosamine is an amino sugar pretreated by the hydrolysis of chitin and generally recognized as safe by the FDA. For the determination of the freezing point of the fish, raw samples were placed at minus 30 degrees C. Temperature in the center of the slice was constantly monitored, and the cooling curve were developed. Untreated and osmotically pretreated slices were packed aerobically and stored isothermally at 2.5 minus 1 and minus 3 degrees C. And appropriate equations were used for the mathematical modeling of microbial growth and temperature dependence of the selected quality deterioration rates. The osmotic pretreatment caused a moisture loss from the fish flesh, as we saw previously. The use of the alternative solutes did not affect significantly the mass transfer between the fish flesh and the osmotic solution. The freezing point of untreated fish was determined at minus 1.8 degrees C. The osmotic pretreatment and the addition of the alternative solutes led to depression of the freezing point. Pseudomonas dominated spoilage at 2.5 degrees C and its growth was inhibited significantly after osmotic pretreatment. The sensory scores were modeled by parent zero order lines. For super chilling storage, the quality deterioration was attributed to dehydration due to reduced water holding capacity and textural changes, mainly increased hardness, which was observed by sensory evaluation. Trehalose and glucosamine showed a cryoprotective effect, maintaining freshness characteristics for longer times as compared with the untreated samples. Osmotic treatment together with super chilled storage maintained fish freshness for longer times. Samples treated with alternative solutes exhibited higher sensory scores, with trehalose and glucosamine showing no significant changes. Again, in this case, temperature dependence of the quality loss rate was modeled firstly by the Arrhenius equation. However, the Arrhenius model in this case was not appropriate for the whole temperature rates between minus 3 and 15 degrees C. But it described adequately the temperature dependence separately for sub-zero and chilled temperatures for untreated and multiple extracted samples. That's why there is a completely different mechanism of quality degradation the two temperature ranges, which is microbial spoilage for the temperatures above the 0 degrees C, and lipid oxidation or textural changes at sub-zero temperatures. In this case, for the whole range, we used another mathematical model, which is Davy model, and could describe the temperature dependence at the whole temperature range. And we developed the similar mathematical models for the calculation of shelf life at any storage temperature. So we conclude that the results of the study show the potential of using osmotic pretreatment with trehalose and glucosamine to extend the shelf life of fish products. Superchilled storage gave additional shelf life increase of pretreated fillets, and the proposed models can be a reliable tool for predicting the shelf life of minimally pretreated sea bream during the superchilled storage. Now we're leaving MAP and osmotic dehydration. Nowadays, consumers prefer minimally processed additive-free foods with fresh-like characteristics. This led to the investigation of novel processing methods such as high hydrostatic pressure. This technology can inactivate microorganisms in foods without the need of high temperatures, increasing shelf life of perishable products without compromising sensory quality. A high pressure processing, high hydrostatic pressure is environmentally friendly and consumes much less energy than thermal pasteurization. The advantage of high pressure treatment over traditional thermal processing is a better retention of nutritional and sensory properties. In order to realize the amount of pressure during high pressure treatment, we can say that 1,000 megapascal, which is a pressure value that is used in this case, is equivalent to the weight of two elephants on a quadratic centimeter, or more than the pressure at the deepest ocean. So how does the high pressure work? There are three components to the technology depending on what is being processed. These are pressure, hold time, and temperature during processing. During processing, the products are loaded into a processing vessel. The vessel is filled with water and pressure is uniformly distributed around the whole product. Finally, the sample is removed from the vessel. The only limitation for high hydrostatic pressure application is the water content of the product. Air-filled products are compressed by hydrostatic pressure, while water-dense foods are not deformed by hydrostatic pressure. Mm-hmm. So high pressure can be used on most moisture-containing foods, ranging from prepackaged, ready-to-eat, to fresh products. It makes sense for high-quality products where traditional treatments can harm the quality. Now I'll show you the effect of high-pressure processing on gillhead sea bream fillet. The processing conditions that were applied in this case were 600 megapascal for 5 minutes at environmental temperature. High pressure reduced the initial microbial load of fish fillet and inhibited microbial growth. It affected significantly the appearance of the fillet, increasing the lightness. The fillet became opaque, which is associated with protein denaturation. Textural changes were also observed. Hardness and cohesiveness increased and adhesiveness decreased after the treatment, and this was judged as positive during sensory evaluation. The processing led to significant sensory quality improvement as reported by the panelists. And the shelf life of Cyprium fillets was significantly extended after the treatment. Conclusively, high pressure is a novel process which may be used to inactivate microorganisms in certain foods without the need of high temperatures and increasing shelf life of perishable products without compromising sensory quality. The advantage of this treatment over traditional thermal processing rests on a better retention of nutritional and sensory properties. High pressure treatment can extend the shelf life of seafood, effectively cold pasteurizing the products, reducing the initial load and delaying microorganisms' growth.
Fanny, sorry to interrupt. Isn't it a serious con when you make the flesh appearing more opaque after being pressurized?
It's not common because the consumers know that the fillets are somehow gray when they bat. But if it is it's proposed, it can be commercialized as a semi-processed.
Something different, a new product or something.
A ready-to-cook product or a part of a ready meal.
Yes, but you haven't tested to the consumer preferences,
no.
In relevance to consumer preferences.
The third part of the presentation refers to cold chain management. It is generally recognized by the European industry, retailers, food authorities, even consumers, that the weakest link that affects directly safety and quality of chilled products is the actual chill chain. A big percentage of foodborne disease is due to temperature abuse. The application of an optimized quality and safety assurance system for chilled distribution of fresh chilled products requires continuous monitoring, control of storage conditions from production to the point of consumption. The systematic management of the chilled chain and the improved evaluation of safety, quality, and shelf life of the products can lead to reduced safety risk and increased quality with a significant health and economic impact to the society and the market. Nowadays, there is a decrease of focus on end product testing and verification, traditional cornerstones of quality and regulatory control. So it's important to develop and apply a structured quality assurance system based on prevention by monitoring, controlling, and recording of critical parameters through products' entire life cycle. Here is a scene of temperature monitoring for Kilkhead Cyprium from harvest to final consumption. Temperature is monitored with miniature data loggers. The route this experiment followed was Chios to Piraeus port by commercial boat, a land transport to Patra port, storage at a distribution center, sea transport from Patra to Ancona port of Italy, distribution and sale throughout Italy. The time temperature history of products recorded by the data logger shows significant temperature fluctuations. Temperature abuse at any stage of the cold chain may result in quality loss. For this reason, continuous monitoring of the time temperature history of food is of great importance. Additionally, the systematic study and modeling of the temperature dependence of shelf life is required for the estimation of the quality at any stage of the cold chain. Such practical systems are time temperature integrators. A large number of TTIs have been developed. First of all, we have asked to say what is a time temperature integrator. They are simple and inexpensive devices that can show an easily measurable time and temperature dependent change that cumulatively indicates the time temperature history of the products from the point of manufacture to the consumer allowing the location and the improvement of the critical points of the chill chain. These indicators can be diffusion-based, microbial, enzymatic, polymer-based, and photochromic. These are really TTIs of various types. I'll show you some examples. An enzymatic TTI works like this. The indicator starts with two liquid-filled boxes, heat sealed in plastic. The contents are mixed by bursting the seal between the pots by pressure. And after exposure to time and temperature, the contents turn from green to yellow or to red, depending on the indicator type. This type of TTI is used for monitoring catered meals on board British Airways flights. The color change of a microbial TTI is caused by a controlled microbial growth. This TTI is based on a diffusion reaction concept that causes the color change of the indicator from yellow to pink. This TTI operates on a solid-state polymerization reaction, where a colorless monomer polymerizes and becomes opaque. And this is another diffusion reaction system. There are several TTI types. The photochromic TTI is a solid-state reaction indicator based on a photochemical reaction. The temperature dependence of this TTI is a function of charging time. Our laboratory participates in several projects regarding cold chain management, such as SMAS, development and application of a TTI-based safety monitoring and assurance system for chilled meat products, fresh label integrated approach to enable traceability of the cold chain of fresh chilled meat and fish products by means of tailor-made time temperature indicators. IQ Fresh Label, developing novel intelligent labels for chilled and frozen food products and promoting the influence of smart labels application on waste reduction, food quality and safety in the European supply chain. And Frisbee, food refrigeration innovations for safety, consumers benefit, environmental impact and energy optimization along the cold chain in Europe. The mathematical models that we described previously are necessary for the development of a monitoring-based system, based on TTIs. We need to know very well the quality changes of the target food during storage, and then study the response kinetics of the tested indicators. Then we combine all this information in order to select the appropriate indicators for each product. An adequate TTI for a food product shows similar temperature sensitivity, namely it's a similar activation energy values and a similar self-life at its storage temperature. So we move back to the case study with the MAP Gilhead Sebring fillets, and we now see the application of TTIs. So we had Gilhead Sebring fillets stored aerobically and in three different MAP conditions. And we had constructed the self-life curves using the developed mathematical models. We tested the photochromic TTI and we at several storage temperatures and at different charging times. And similar, we constructed mathematical models of the TTI response based on temperature and time. And using this mathematical model, we construct similar self-life plots for this time for the TTI. By combining the two figures, we can find the label that best matches the self-life curve of the target food. In this case, we have Gilhead Sebring fillets stored in 50% CO2 and 50% air. And we saw that if we charge this TTI for 2 seconds, we will have an adequate match for self-life monitoring. And coming back to the filters that we described previously, we applied these indicators. We attached the TTIs on half of the 80 packages and tried to apply a least self-life first out system based on TTIs as an alternative to first in first out system at the decision point. So what we did is at the decision point, which was 72 hours after packaging, the products were split according to the TTI color reading using a visual scale. So we measured the color of each TTI. And based on this selection, the products were sorted according to their temperature history. There was a split into two subgroups. The 20 more temperature abused belonged to products for the local market, and the rest of them belonged to products for the distant market. Both groups were stored in two temperature cabinets, simulating the domestic storage. And we had the microbiological analysis at the time of consumption. Here is the effective temperature for the whole distribution chain for all samples, for the FIFO handle products. And we saw that the TTI sorting resulted in promoting the more temperature abused products to be consumed first. We calculated the microbial log counts for each date of microbiological analysis and showed that different distribution of microbial load was reported in the two groups. The distribution of microbiological growth moves to the left to lower values for the TTI-bearing products. Conclusively, a TTI-based management system can improve quality of the fish still chain. The selection and use of the optimum TTIs for a particular product with regards to its visual response characteristics and temperature sensitivity could lead to realistic control of the chill chain, reduction of waste, and efficient self-life management. The mathematical models that were developed combined with the use of TTIs could be an effective tool for monitoring the quality of chilled fish fillets during distribution and storage. Here is a short presentation of Laboratory of Food Chemistry and Technology, National Technical University of Athens. The main research activities include kinetics of chilled and frozen food during post-processing, quality and self-life predictive modeling, non-thermal processing of foods, and development and application of temperature integrator systems as quality monitors of food products and management of the food chill chain. Some recent publications about food processing and self-life kinetic studies and cold chain management and TTI development in use, and relevant book chapters.
Thank you, Fanny. Thank you very much. Are there any questions among the audience? Something you want to